Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Today, let us study a few things. Who God is and how he came about to create Satan. God is the only one omnipotent spirit, and he has three souls or persons within him with perfect holiness. And Satan works as another Jesus, a false Christ, and antichrist. I have a few links and that are needed, and a few scripture verses written with a transcript on the website. So I may not read them all for want of time. Let us begin. God created us all. We are all living beings, and we are better than animals in intelligence, in using our hands, and in education. The best education we get is from the Bible, because the Bible tells us that we are souls and we can receive our spirit from God. We also learn that there is paradise for our eternal blessed life if we obey God in a common level, and there are heavens if we obey God in an intensive level. And if we are evil, we will face the consequences according to the level of evil we do. The book of Psalms, chapter 14, verse 1, and book of Psalms, verse chapter 53, verse 1, say that the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So, if we do not have enough intelligence to understand the Bible, or to discern God, or to receive spiritual substances, we are foolish. God is three souls inside one and only omnipotent spirit. Omnipotent is all powerful spirit from whom nothing is impossible. For him, nothing is impossible. God existed before all things, and he is the creator of all that are visible and invisible. John chapter 4, verse 24 says, God is a spirit. This spirit is omnipotent. Three souls, or we may say three persons, are nested inside the spirit God. Because of its omnipotent power, this spirit is God. And since these three souls are nested inside the omnipower spirit, they are also God. The attributes of the spirit of God is omnipotence, omnipresence, and omniscience. And the attributes of the persons are souls, are holiness and righteousness. So God is all-powerful and the most righteous and holy. These three persons in God are God the Father and God the Son, and who is Jesus Christ, and the Holy Ghost. In the Old Testament, they are referred as God the Most High, who is the highest, God the Word, and the Spirit of God. And in this case, the Spirit of God is a person, that is a soul. Excuse me. But this Spirit of God is not a spirit, it's a soul. But his body, the omnipotent spirit, that is spirit. So we may say that God is three souls in one omnipotent spirit. Theologians have introduced the word Trinity for God and brought unnecessary confusion. Trinity doctrine has few errors, but we're not going into that now. Let me explain the anatomy of God with this simple example. I have a body, and so I am one body and one person. In my body, there is one brain to tell the body what to do, one heart to supply life through the blood to the body to do works, and one muscle structure to do the works. So my body have three integral parts. So I am three parts, but still I am one man, but not three. So I am one man with three vital parts for three different functions. So also that one omnipotent spirit God has three vital persons to do different functions in holiness and righteousness, and God is still one, as I am one person with my brain, heart, and muscles. The fact is, the three holy, righteous persons are part of the one omnipotent spirit God. The Bible says that it is a mystery fellowship. Those three are in fellowship, but it's a mystery. Why is it a mystery? Because unless you are a spiritual person, you will not understand it. We cannot understand it by our intellect. So it's a mystery fellowship in God. Spiritual people understand the mystery, and the wise people of the world and will get confused with it, because the things of God is spiritual. Please note this, this is the only one God, and there is no other God. Other gods are counterfeit, and they do not fit this criteria of God. So if they don't fit the criteria of God, then they are not God. God is the only one creator of all that came and will be coming to existence. Whatever is coming to existence and whatever already existed is all created by only one God. Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 says, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth." The context refers to the creation of our solar system. And verse 6 says, "Let there be firmaments in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters." Waters from the waters. Here, the waters refers to the mass of the universe. So God separated a little portion from the universe, and He created our solar system from that portion. Verse 16 says, "He made the stars also." So it is evident that God has already created the universe. Yeah, star is like a sun. Each sun has a solar system. Several suns that are stars have solar systems. Every sun and every star has solar systems for it. Together, they are called the Milky Way. Many Milky Ways are called a galaxy. Many galaxies are the universe. And God created them all. So God has created the universe before He created our solar system. The solar system has our world, sun, moon, everything. Further, God created three archangels, Lucifer, Michael, and Gabriel, and a lot of angels with them, which are spirits. When iniquity was found in one of the archangels, Lucifer, at the Garden of Eden, God cursed him to be Satan. God also cursed those angels who have joined with Satan to be the devils. So there are angels and devils. Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 says, "God created." Here, God is mentioned in singular, God created. It refers to as one spirit, one spirit God, and three persons are included in His spirit. Verse 2 says, "The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." Here, the Spirit of God refers to one of the persons in God. And He was also in creation, to join together to create. In the book of Job, chapter 26, verse 13, chapter 33, verse 4, and the book of Psalms, chapter 104, verse 30, Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 35, and Hebrews chapter 10 verse 5, and we see that the Spirit of God, who is the Holy Ghost in the New Testament, is involved in creation with God the Most High and God the Word. Those three, God the Most High, God the Word, and the Spirit of God. Gospel of John chapter 1 verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Here we see two persons as God in the beginning. Verse 3 says, "All things were made by Him." It is referred to Jesus Christ. "And without Him was not anything made that was made." That is, God the Word created all things when He in the beginning. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 9 says, God created all things by Jesus Christ. The New Testament name is Jesus Christ. Here, God the Father told Jesus Christ to create, and Jesus Christ created all things. If we include the Spirit of God as in Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, there are three persons in creation. God made man a soul and may give him the Spirit, but man must ask God for the Spirit to be born again. The creation of man is very important among all creations. He created man in three different days and assembled them together as one. The first day creation of God is light, that is spirit. We say created light, but it is spirit. It is the spirit of man, and it is also called the Holy Spirit because it gives holiness to people. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 3, God said, let there be light, and there was light. So the Most High God said to bring the light, and Jesus Christ, who was God the Word, has created and brought the light to him. Verse 4 says, God divided the light from the darkness. That is, God did not allow this light to merge with darkness. Darkness is the devil, that's evil. Anything is evil, pertain to the devil, is our darkness. So this light is spirit, but not the illumination light. So when they say, it says the light, first day creation, but that is spirit, but that's not the illumination. The illumination light always diffuses to merge with the darkness. When the intensity light goes further, and it will merge with the darkness, and the intensities go down, then it will become darkness. So it will merge into and then connect with the darkness. This is the illumination light. But spiritual light, the light is the Holy Spirit, and it will not merge with the evil spirit. It will keep itself distinctly different. The book of Psalms chapter 139 verse 14 says, and I am fearfully and wonderfully made, my soul knows the right world. So the creation of man is wonderful, our soul know it, and so we are the souls. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image. In our image, there is more than one. There's three persons in God. They were making, they're creating man in their image. Their common image is there's two of them, spirit and soul. In our likeness. One is an image, one is in likeness. So the three souls of God were together to create man. It was to create man with two features. One in their own image, and which was the same as their souls. And the next is after their likeness, and which was to look like their spirit. The Spirit of God is omnipotent, and God did not make our spirit as omnipotent. If we compare God's spirit to the light and of the sun, we say God's spirit is the sun is full of fire. We cannot even look straight in the sun. That much intensity the sun has, this bright light. But when we compare to that, our spirit is like a candlelight. Even we can blow it out, we can put it out. So that feeble our spirit is. So our spirit is no way, it is light, both are light, so it is similar, but not the same. In the first day of creation, light, but our souls were made as the same as the souls of God. It is identical, it is equal, almost, it is same identical, the same image. So man was created, the soul is the same as God's soul, and the light is way feeble, just the likeness. So we also have flesh body. God put the three together and made a complete man. God's Word became a man who was Jesus. God, how did God, the omnipotent spirit, he is a spirit, the omnipotent spirit, he is way powerful, he created even the sun, that much power he has, that kind of spirit he was, became a man in the flesh, like us. Let us see how he became man. God is soul in the omnipotent spirit, but your soul inside that omnipotent spirit. The soul is God created our soul is the same as His soul. So soul is like our soul, but the body, the spirit is way potent. God made the soul of man the exact image of His own soul. So both souls are identical. God's soul, our soul are identical, and so excuse me. Sorry. And so they are exchangeable. Soul is a true person, but body holds the power and identity. Body has the power. Our body is the flesh body. It has the power of the flesh only. But God's body is omnipotent. It can create the whole world. So there is superpower. So God is God because of His omnipotent spirit. If a soul of God came out of His omnipotent spirit body and entered the man's body, the soul will become a man, but will not be God anymore because he came out of the omnipotent body. Now he's entered the flesh body of the man, so it is man because the soul is identical, same. So only one thing is he changed the body from the omnipotent to the man, so now he is a man. So then he will have only the power and the strength of a man, but not of the omnipotent spirit. God has three souls, and one of the persons is God the Word, and he asked God the Father in Hebrew chapter 10, verse 5 and 7, to prepare a body for him to come to the world as a man to do the will of God the Father. So, God the Father and God the Holy Ghost have created a body in the womb of a Virgin Mary, and that's in Luke chapter 1, verse 30 to 35, and it's also in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 21. And I have the scripture verses on the transcript. And the soul of God, God the Word, came out of the omnipotent spirit and moved into the flesh body, which was just created in the womb of Mary, and thus God became flesh, as in John chapter 1, verse 14. He was Jesus. Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 and 7 say that the man Jesus ceased to be God. He ceased to be God, and he let go all the equal status with God and all the omnipotent power of God, and he did not keep any reputation of God with him, and he became a mere man and a servant to God, and he refused to be as God when he became a man. Man Jesus lived as a man approved of God, but he did not live as God. The Gospel of John chapter 1 verse 14 says that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. The book of Acts chapter 2 verse 22 says, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, because he's approved. God showed them he's approved of by me. So he showed the miracles to prove that. So God the Word withdrew from being God, became an ordinary man of flesh, and lived as 100% man, but he did receive the power, grace, and spirit of God. And anybody could receive them. And he was approved by God. Being a man, he was crucified and was dead. God raised him and joined his soul in the omnipotent spirit as he was before. And so he became God again as before. But theologians say that he was still God even when he was a man, and contradicting the truth of the Bible and many scripture verses. So they have their own reasons and intentions for their false preaching. But the Bible says that God the Word became and lived as a genuine man, fully obeying God the Father. But of course, with the power of God, because God's power was within, the Spirit was within. And well, every man should receive the power. We can also receive the same power. That's the power Jesus Christ, Jesus, when he was a man, he received, and he lived a holy life. The power and the presence of God was always with him. God will give such power to any person, and who will submit to God to obey Him. If we submit to God to obey Him, we will also receive the power. It is in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 12. It says, "As many as received Him, to them He gave power to become the sons of God." We also will receive the power if you wanted to. There are links for the study, and you can refer that too. Most churches preach false Jesus Christ. How to find out the true Jesus Christ from the false Jesus Christ? You may not believe it. The true Jesus Christ, Satan posed himself as the false, as Jesus Christ. So he's a false Jesus Christ, and the true Jesus Christ is the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. So there are two Jesus Christ in our churches. As a man, Jesus was crucified and killed, lost the flesh body, and so God the Father and the God the Holy Ghost took his soul and joined him in the omnipotent spirit body, and he was as before, and thus he became God again. He is the true Lord Jesus Christ. The only one omnipotent spirit is God. Three persons are nested in this spirit. This is in the mystery fellowship, and we saw that before, but I'm just repeating. And so these three persons are also God individually and collectively. One of the persons now is Jesus Christ. Before he was God the Word, now it's Jesus Christ. Christians take the name to represent the omnipotence. But we just said God is Jesus Christ. Jesus, when say Jesus Christ, we represent the omnipotent spirit. The spirit we can do everything with all power, because Jesus, all power is given to me, and those kind of things. So we just say Jesus Christ, but we actually mean, referred to God, the Spirit, the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, who is an omnipotent spirit. So he is God. So he is in spirit, not in the flesh body anymore. After resurrection, he is in the spirit body, omnipotent spirit body, which includes the three persons. Other two persons are with Jesus Christ. All three persons are in there. But we just say, use the name for vocabulary sake, we just say God, he is Jesus Christ. But actually, we did not deny the other two persons. The other two persons are also in the spirit. So when you say Jesus, we refer them all. But he is not three persons. He is one of the three persons. But Satan enters the Bible as another Jesus in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2-4. Calls him also as Jesus Christ. So Bible refers him as another Jesus Christ. He twists the scriptures, and 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4 says, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, let me read that. Who opposeth and exalteth, this is referring to Satan, and he opposeth and exalteth above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he has sitteth, he as God sitteth in the temple of God. So that's the churches. We go to churches to worship God. But he sneaked into the church. God said, I will not be in the buildings which built by the hands, so I will rather live in the hearts of the people. So the true Jesus Christ in the spirit, he lives in the hearts of the people, not in the building. But this guy, Satan, he show himself as God. He sitteth in the temple, in the churches, as God. So he cleverly switches, showing himself that he is God. It is scripture. So actually, literally, Jesus Christ is not in the building, he is in the hearts of the people. But the false Jesus, who is Satan in disguise, is in the pulpit or in the building. So the God in the building is Satan in disguise, but the true God is in the hearts of the true people. So, according to the Bible, we have the true Jesus Christ, and we also have Satan showing himself as Jesus Christ and is receiving our worship as God. So, how to find which Jesus Christ do we worship as our God? This is how. We all have needs. Christians also have needs. We all have needs. And we believe in God, and we will pray to God for our needs. So please listen to our own prayer. If our primary prayer is for the needs of our life, our worldly life, for our family, for job, is also needed, but what's the prayer? For our health and for such things, and we thank God for salvation. God, we thank you for giving us salvation. You saved us. We thank you for eternal life. And all these things, we take it for granted. We thank him for that. And then our God is another Jesus. That is not the true Jesus Christ, who is Satan in disguise. So we think, because that's the way we taught the preachers and the pastors and the traditional Christianity taught that way. So we pray to the God without our conscience. We pray to another Jesus for the provisions of the world. Satan is the one promising eternal life freely for believing that he's God. Satan says, as another Jesus say, believe Jesus Christ, then you will have eternal life. That's a lie. He is the one preaching that message. If we believe the message and we take the eternal life for granted, we ask just for the things of the world, so then we are worshipping the false Jesus Christ, who is Satan in disguise. Instead, if our primary prayer, we ask for more power from God, as in John chapter 1 verse 12, and to be led by the Spirit, as in Romans chapter 8 verse 14, according to his will, according to God's will, but not for the things of the world, then our God is the true God, Lord Jesus Christ. See, our mind, from what we are asking, we can discern who we are asking. So if our asking is for eternal things, then the God we are asking is the true Lord Jesus Christ. If we are asking for material things, the God we are asking is for, it is a Satan in disguise as Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33, Jesus Christ himself said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God. Ask those things and his righteousness, and all the other things will be added unto you. So you don't even have to ask. God knows what you need. Jesus Christ himself said, you don't have to ask those things. Ask the eternal things. But the traditional church teach you to ask the worldly things. So the traditional church and the pastors and the preachers guide you to the false Jesus Christ, and the scripture lead you to the true Jesus Christ. So you, this Jesus Christ in our heart, and we'll pray according to his will. The true Jesus Christ, he's in our heart. If his Holy Spirit is in us, we will be guided by the Spirit, and we'll ask eternal things, heavenly things. It is important that we verify that which Jesus Christ we worship. Eve, in the beginning, listened to Satan and was thrown out of paradise, and paradise was part of heaven. Satan has come to Christians as another Jesus Christ, false Christ, and antichrist, and he is also seated in the worship places in which are churches, and with the name Jesus Christ, and receives our worship, and we are cheated, we are deceived. I have a lesson to teach this one. You may look at the link for details. Jesus Christ tells us to obey his commandments. True Jesus Christ gives us commandments and asks us to obey. The false Jesus Christ said, never mind, I will love you with unconditional love. Jesus is love. When they say Jesus just loved you with unconditional love, they are preaching you another Jesus Christ, who is Satan. So that's not the true Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, gave you commandments, ask you to obey. That's for your own benefit. When God the Word became man, Jesus, he let down all omnipotent powers, obeyed God perfectly, and asked us also to obey God in the same way. Now, Jesus Christ is resurrected, and he is in the omnipotent spirit, highly exalted above hell, earth, and heavens. And we all must bow our knees. We must confess that he is Lord. Lord means master. And he is our owner. He owns us. We must recognize that. Don't treat him as our friend, as our buddy, and those kind of things. Now we familiarize Jesus Christ. The familiar Jesus Christ is Satan in disguise. So we must obey the true Lord Jesus Christ all the time with reverence, not only when we worship him. It is in Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 to 12. Please read that. When Jesus Christ became God again, all power was given back to him. He told people to teach them to obey his commandments for their eternal life. It is in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. He will not beg us or plead us to obey him. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 to 10 say that the true Jesus Christ, who is in the omnipotent spirit, will take vengeance on them who neither know Jesus Christ. We say, we must know the true Jesus Christ. But don't take it for granted and take the false Jesus Christ as the true Jesus Christ. We must know them. And so he will take vengeance on them who neither know Jesus Christ nor obey Jesus Christ in flaming fire throughout eternity. As God, Jesus Christ will judge the whole world at the end, reward his people, and punish evil people in the lake of fire. The gospel is to obey his commandments, and whoever do not obey his gospel will be punished in the lake of fire with everlasting destruction. He is the only one God. All other gods are venerated as God. They are not real gods. And most of them do not even exist. They imagine something as God. They built the gods in their own mind. And otherwise, worship the idols and those kind of things, false stories and people, venerated people, they worship as God. However, false prophets can show wonders and by the power of Satan and the devils. Just because if you believe the wonders and the miracles and the healings and those kind of things, manifestations, you'll be deceived very easily, because the false Jesus Christ will also do that. True Jesus Christ also will do that. So they do miracles and even healings and deceive even the very elect people. You think just because they do some miracles and some healing, they are true. No. Don't. That is not the sign. The sign for the true Jesus Christ, the true workers, is entirely different. But Satan, as another Jesus, says that he loves people unconditionally, accept all filthy sinners as they are. Come as you are. He's with love. And so those kind of things, we listen to that kind of preaching. And please know it, that they're preaching the false Jesus Christ, who is another Jesus. So he says, I will receive you as bride. So it is in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 2 to 4. Another Jesus will promote false doctrine and he give false spirit and through his servant preachers. They are servant of Satan, or false Jesus Christ. Tell sinners to come to Jesus Christ as they are. One of the examples, Dr. Billy Graham, he gave altar calls the same way. He's a servant of the devil. But if I say Dr. Billy Graham, well, not only Billy Graham, there's thousands of them, thousands of prominent people are servants of the devil. But if I tell them, it will be offensive and people will hate me. That's okay. But that's the truth. Whoever preaches that, come as you are, God is with love. No, obey him. Then only you'll come. You can come to him. If you don't obey him, he won't get you near him. False Christ also show miracles, manifestations, and deceive believers of Jesus. If you are Jesus Christ, be careful. Jesus Christ says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 24, for there shall arise false Christ. It is Jesus Christ himself saying it. Shall arise false Christ, false prophets, shall show great signs and wonders, in so much as if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Jesus could have elected you for high calling, but they could deceive you. So be careful. It's a statement of Jesus Christ himself. But Christians think that miracle manifestations are signs of the true servants of Jesus Christ. But Jesus Christ himself says that there are false Christ. If both true and false. True servant of Jesus Christ do miracles, the false servants of Jesus Christ also miracles. And so how do we find out the true servants from the false servants? Are the true Jesus Christ from the false Jesus Christ? It is by their fruits, by their fruits. Fruits are their lives and the true messages of holiness and humbleness and righteousness for the inheritance in heaven through eternity. If somebody, so their life, we cannot follow it and we cannot, they can deceive you when you see them, they pretend as they're holy people. There would be, that's what Pharisees and the scribes, and they did it. They did a fantastic job in showing people as righteous people, but they're not righteous. So, same way we can, by the life. But the life we cannot worship. But listen to them, what the message, what they preach. They preach you to get to heaven without holiness, without righteousness, without obeying God. They are of false Jesus Christ, of the devil. Instead, if their life and messages are for holiness and righteousness, and they will take you to heaven, but otherwise the profit, comfort, fame, status, other things of the world will take you to hell. Money, prosperity, for all the things. Obeying God and holiness and is for heaven. Their manifestations from, be careful. It is. Don't look at just the manifestations, like healings and miracles and show wonders. Don't just look at it, because both of them doing these things. But look what they preach, the message. So message is for righteousness and holiness and obeying God, then you got it. They are the true servants of God. It is for profit and this and that, and how to manipulate God and how to get profit from him. So they are from the devil. They are false. That's the test. Please be aware of that. We must be careful on this warning by Jesus Christ himself. I have a lesson for this one. You can follow the link. According to the Bible, the Antichrist and the Antichrist, which is in plural, are here for the last 2,000 years. And who are they? 2,000 years. Antichrist and Antichrist, which is in plural, both are here in this world from the first century, from the time of the apostles, even now, and it'll continue. And Antichrist is mentioned in singular as well as in plural. If we study the scriptures carefully, we will know that the singular Antichrist is Satan. And the plural Antichrists are the people who follow Satan. But many theologians teach that Antichrist will be a man and who will be the world leader and who will come and this and that. A lot of books are written, they make a lot of prophets, and they speak, the sermons and the books are wonderful. They convince you. They're all wrong. No man can be living as a leader for the group of people for the last 2,000 years and even now to continue. No man will fit that category. It is Satan. He lives for a long time. And the verse says that you have heard. That's what the scripture says. You have heard when somebody told you. They're telling the lies. Don't believe them. That's what the scripture says. So you have scripture by the inspiration of God. It is written by inspiration of God. It is revealed by the revelation of God. You don't have the revelation, sometimes you don't understand, because it is a stumbling stone for the false people to fall. So he said, you have heard. So you have heard means that's not the truth. You're not hearing the truth. You're hearing a lie. But it's not say that Satan, Jesus will be coming, but a man will be coming. It's not looking for a man. He's already here, that's Satan. So they heard a lie, a rumor, but not the truth. 1 John chapter 2, verse 18 says, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, let me read that. 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. Verse 18, little children, it is the last time, and As you have heard, antichrist shall come. Even now are many antichrists where we know that the lesson. So you heard that antichrist will come, but there are many antichrists even now. That means you don't have to come because he's the leader. He's already there. See, that's what it says. So you have heard antichrist will come. So that's what you heard. There's a rumor is there. They say antichrist shall come, and they refer to the theologians and preachers also say the same thing. Even now they say the antichrist shall come. Even now theologians say, we ask them, they say antichrist will be looking forward to that. The famous John MacArthur says the antichrist shall come as the world ruler, world leader. That's what other people, not only MacArthur, everybody puts that. And the scripture being fulfilled on them, they say they will come. See, these people are saying. So scripture is fulfilled on them. They are false preachers. They are educated, but foolish. We have antichrist here for the last 2,000 years. And who are they? Verse 22. Who is a liar but he that denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist and denies the Father and the Son. Who deny their relationship, that's the Antichrist. So what's the word? Christ means the Son of God. Christ, the Son of God, always company. So Christ means the Son of God. But the preachers is something else. They say it's anointing, this and that, they bluff. Even from the beginning, Satan challenged the relationship of Jesus Christ and God as Son and Father. When Satan was tempting Jesus in the wilderness, just before he entered the ministry, Satan came and tempted him, and he was challenging, if you are the Son of God, do this. So you're Son of, say, always. They challenged him to prove whether he was the Son of God. Pharisees wanted to kill Jesus because Jesus claimed that God was his Father. So they will not admit that. So they are of Antichrist. So the high priest passed his verdict and says, now what proof we need more? He admitted. So when Jesus has admitted that he was the Christ, the Son of God, and so they want to kill him. All other religions, Mormons, the cults deny the sonship of God, but they will accept Jesus as a prophet, as a great teacher, and so on. But they will not accept him as a Father and Son, two individuals. So they will not accept that, two persons. But Christians will have no problem. We accept that. And among Christians, there's a group called Jesus Only. They're a cult. Jesus Only, I call him Jesus Only cult. And he's the only so-called Christians that I know of deny the Father and Son relationship. They will not accept the Father and Son of the two people. They give some kind of goofy explanations to say they both are one. And they call the Father and Son are one person and so on. That's just nonsense. But all Christians accept they accept Father and Son relationship as God, as two people, except the Jesus Only group. So in general, there are no antichrists among Christians except this Jesus Only group, as far as this criteria is concerned. Father and Son, they're the two persons, and this criteria is concerned, no Christians are antichrists, everybody's clean. 1 John chapter 4, verse 2 and 3. 1 John chapter 4, 4, verse 2 and 3. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God, every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Is a different criteria. Before there's a father-son relationship criteria. Here, that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. If we admit that Jesus was just the man Jesus, God the Word, became a flesh man, if you admit that, then you are of God. And verse 3, And every spirit there confesseth not. You don't confess that. If your spirit is not confessed that Jesus Christ has come from the flesh, is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof, and you have heard that it should come. So again, he said, you heard of that it should come. See, there are people, the rumor people, they tell this message and spread this message. You heard. Excuse me. That Antichrist. Please look at this very carefully. We see 2 points here. First, it tells who the Antichrist is. He's the spirit, and he's on so many people. He gathered a lot of people, influencing them. And so, in this context, it is Satan. We already explained before it was Satan. Again, it says that you have heard that it should come. And even now, already he is in the world. He's already in the world, that means for 2,000 years. And he's here, that's Satan. Man cannot be for 2,000 years. So, Satan, the spirit was already there, but preachers are looking forward to a world leader to come as the Antichrist. Secondly, it says that we must confess that when God the Word became a man, he was made flesh, as in John chapter 1 verse 14, God was made flesh, but he was not showing him. So don't interpret them, oh, God came as flesh, you see him as flesh, but he's God. No, don't say that. That means he's showing himself as flesh, he did not become flesh. No, we must say that we must realize, and we must admit, we must receive the fact that he became flesh. He's not so showing himself as flesh. That means he did not become flesh. He's God, still God, but you see him as flesh. So he's showing, no, that's baloney. Don't accept that, that's garbage. Preachers say that he's 100% man and 100% God, as if he's showing as God, but he's a man. So don't buy that. That is, he was God and man. And at the same time, they're the combination of things. So that is refusing to confess, that is refusing to accept that he became just flesh. Because there's a lot of implications behind it, but that's not time to time to teach that. I have already taped, so you can look at it. Such preachers are believers of Antichrist according to scriptures, because they are not confessing him as mere flesh. 2 John chapter 1 verse 7. 2 John chapter 1 verse 7 says, as many deceivers are entered into the world. Deceivers entered in the world who confess not that Jesus Christ come in the flesh. They will not accept, they will not confess that Jesus was Jesus came, he was pure, he was flesh. He's not God in there. It was flesh. He declined all the gods. That's Ephesians chapter 2 verse 3, sorry, the reference. This is the deceiver and Antichrist. So these are the Antichrists. So in this criteria also, a lot of Christians are Antichrist by this criteria. So this verse also agrees with 1 John chapter 2 verse, chapter 4 verses 2 and 3. And First John, John chapter 1, verse 14, and Jesus came as just a flesh. Now, so many pastors and preachers are in this camp teaching Christians that the man Jesus was God while he was a man, but it appears to be very innocent. But it's not innocent. It is, but the one behind it is it's Satan showing himself as Antichrist, and it is there. Satan's preachers, and they not only this twist, they bring a lot of twists. Don't touch them, don't accept them. But scripture says, those who do not confess that the man Jesus was just flesh like any other man, and they are Antichrists, they are Antichrist, plural. And Satan is the Antichrist, that's a singular. For details, and I have a link there, you can refer that. Satan shows himself that he is God and he is worshipped by Christians and as God and as Jesus Christ. End time ministries are famous nowadays, and they write a lot of books and a lot of sermons, a lot of gimmicks, and so they're popular, they make a lot of money. Called end time ministries. And preachers say that Jesus Christ may come at any time. Everything is ready for his coming. And so this very, very fluently they say, yeah, everything's ready for coming. They even know that Jesus won't come. Come now, for another 300 years, he will not come. So the end of the world will come any time, and Jesus will be coming any time. He will rapture the people and will be disappearing. All this garbage they preach, and they write books, and they become famous, and they get rich, and all these kind of things. All things are ready for the coming of Jesus Christ. But the fact of the Bible says that he will not come, at least for 300 years for the rapture, and he will not come for another 2,100 years for the end of the world, according to scriptures. And if you want to listen, and then I have a link for that. Before the rapture, the son of perdition, Satan, and who is sitting in the worship places, which is church, a minute ago I explained that, he's worshiping in the building. The building is filled. He's sitting in the building is another Jesus, and who is Satan, but who is sitting in the heart of the righteous peoples are the true Jesus Christ. So, who is sitting in the buildings with Satan must be revealed before Jesus comes in. That's the prerequisite. Before this one happened before, and then the other one comes. It is in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3 and 4. And let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there is a falling away of the church, and that the man of sin be revealed, that is the son of perdition, who opposed and exalted himself above that is called God, that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. This is Satan, which is all that a minute ago. And he is there. This guy, and now nobody knows. So like who was in the scriptures, and the scriptures revealed it, then we know, just close fellowship, and we teach each other. So we are the only one who know. The churches will not know. So this will be revealed to the church. Until then, Jesus will not come. That's the scripture. Until this happens, this must happen. This Satan, which is hiding the name of Jesus Christ in the churches and receiving the worship, must be revealed. Until he is revealed, Jesus will not come for the rapture. That's the scripture. The son of perdition is a symbolic name for Satan. No man can live for more than 100 years and be invisible, that is transparent. And so Satan shows himself as God sitting in the worship places for the last 2023 years already, and he will continue to be here until he will be revealed. He's also in 2 Thessalonians, here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 2, verse 4. And 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4, and Matthew chapter 24, verse 1. That's another Jesus, another false Christ, and those kind of things. We know this, and we will not fall for the religious rituals and ceremonies and the traditions for our salvation. We will not trust that. Okay, tradition. It's man-made. It's not by revelation of God. Tradition is not the revelation of God. Instead, we will come to the true God. Our eternal life depends on it. Please refer to the link and for the details. Our knowledge of God and scripture is very important for eternal life. Believe me, it is the truth is important. If you are sincere to the lie, and lie is a lie, even if you are very sincere, extra sincere, but if you believe the lie, it's just a lie, you are a liar. So God is spirit, and his body is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. But our body is flesh, so we were weak, and so we have no power. So, God did not require us to do any supernatural works for our eternal life. He did not say do miracles and heal the people and nothing. He did not say to do anything. But God made our souls in the same image of the soul. The soul is same, same as God's soul. So God tells us to live a holy life as Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ comes in, and he has the same flesh as our flesh and the soul as our soul, and he did a holy life, he obeyed God with the same flesh and the same soul as we have. So he lived a holy life obeying God. We must also try to live. We may not be able to live as much as he lived, but we can try at least following his footsteps. That's in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. So obeying the Lord Jesus Christ, and our reward in heaven will be in proportion as much as you strive to obey him in love. As much as you strive. We try hard, more, and your reward will be more. We try just a little bit, your reward will be less. If we believe our preachers and we say that we do not have to obey God and tell us to take our salvation for granted and we'll be in the lake of fire. They will be in the lake of fire. The preachers also will be in the lake of fire. You will follow him and you will be in the lake of fire also. The final message of Jesus Christ in the Bible is in Revelation chapter 22 verses 11 to 14. Jesus Christ says that our reward and inheritance in heaven for eternity will be according to our works. That is in proportion to as much work we do to obey in obedience to his commandments. We obey God, if we obey him, follow sincerely obey him, we will be in heaven someplace, either in paradise, in his temple in paradise, or in the new heavens, or in Mount Zion, where Jesus Christ himself is there, even Father is there, you'll be with him. Thank you for listening. May God bless you. Amen. Thank you.